The best choice here is A, hypoglycemic encephalopathy. Let's look at some of the features that make choice A the best choice in this case. On T2 weighted sequence, you can see there's abnormal hyperdensity associated with the posterior parietal lobe, posterior temporal lobe, and occipital lobe. There's a loss of cortical ribbon. Compare that to the very sharp, nicely defined cortical ribbon anteriorly. On diffusion, you can see clearly restricted diffusion involving the same area, the posterior aspect of the temporal lobe, occipital lobe, as well as parietal lobe. So this is a good pattern for hypoglycemic encephalopathy. Their involvement is bilateral, and the cortical involvement tend to be parietal, occipital lobe, posterior temporal lobe, insula. In other words, posterior distribution, like in this case. Notice a sparing of the anterior aspect, the frontal lobe. Now, the posterior internal capsule, basal ganglia, and hippocampi can also be involved. In neonate, cerebellum, brainstem, the thalami, or the pulvinar thalami, tend to be involved as well. And this can, of course, occur not uncommonly with hypoxic ischemic injury. So let's look at other choices that do not work as well in this case. For PRESS, hypertensive encephalopathy, this is an example of an older child with hypotensive encephalopathy PRESS. Yes, it does have a similar posterior distribution, similar to that of hypoglycemic encephalopathy. However, classically, PRESS does not have restricted diffusion. Often you will see T2 shine through, but majority of PRESS does not have restricted diffusion. So this makes choice B not the best choice in this case. And also, PRESS is quite rare in neonate. The majority of cases tend to occur in adults. Hypoxic ischemic injury. Now, there are different forms of hypoxic ischemic injury depending on when does it occur and how severe the hypoxic ischemic injury is. In preemie, you tend to have effect in the periventricular white matter, so they later on present with periventricular leukomyelomalacia. In term baby, they tend to occur in the white matter or the watershed region. In more severe case, you have involvement of the central gray, so you have basal ganglia and thalami, perirolenic cortex, affecting the primary sensory motor region as well as in brainstem, so region that's metabolically active. And the deep gray structure like basal ganglia, thalami, posterior end of the internal capsule, brainstem, perirolenic region, and hippocampi are independent predictive factors for more adverse outcome or motor dysfunction down the road. This would be an example of a hypoxic ischemic injury in a more severe case. You can see there's an effect of bilateral perirolenic region. You can see involvement of deep gray structure, basal ganglia, caudate nucleus, as well as thalami. So this is more severe hypoxic ischemic injury, unlike hypoglycemic encephalopathy that tend to affect posterior distribution. This is more bilateral process and often involving the central gray if the hypoxic ischemic injury is severe enough. Of course, often a kid can have both processes occur at the same time. For acute ischemic infarction, the territory is distinct of a arterial territory, in this case, a large MCA distribution. Compare that to hypoglycemic encephalopathy, the involvement here tend to involve two territories, such as posterior MCA as well as PCA. So that is different. It's also a bilateral process. That's also unusual for an acute ischemic infarction due to occlusion of a vessel. In this case, there's occlusion of the MCA, leading into a large territorial infarction, sparing the PCA as well as ACA territory. The last choice, neonatal herpes encephalitis. This is an example of such. You can see there's diffuse loss of cortical ribbon, as well as restrict diffusion involving throughout the entire cerebellar hemisphere, including involvement of the corpus callosum. Contrast that to hypoglycemic encephalopathy, where they tend to involve more posterior distribution. Neonatal herpes encephalitis tend to involve more globally. Now, that's different than the herpes encephalitis that we see with adult or older kids, where the classic involvement is the medial temporal lobe, and often shows restrictive fusion, sometimes enhancement, as well as hemorrhage, the limbic system. And those tend to occur with herpes simplex virus 1, the neonatal, the one that involving more globally with a vertical transmission during birth, that majority are due to herpes simplex virus 2. So the pattern is quite different. All in all, the best choice here is going to be A, hypoglycemic encephalopathy. That's all for this pediatric neuro case number 12. Thanks for your attention and good luck on your board exam.